Mark, I guess I'll start with you. You've sort of touched on open data in so many different contexts, both with a company now currently, working with a government recently, and with our nonprofit a few years back. Can you talk a little bit about kind of the experience of opening data from all those different points of view?
It's equally as fun from each different vantage point. Yeah, it's just interesting to see how far we've come. I notice it in my conversations with government officials in each of those capacities. It has definitely changed. There's an increased awareness of the importance of open data and its connection to better government service, better engagement, better outcomes.
What did that process look like when you were in the city of Philadelphia?
Well, Philadelphia has a progressive mayor. Philadelphia's always had an active and engaged developer community. Code for Philly is here. They're awesome. They helped drive this process in Philadelphia. They made it easy for me to be a chief data officer. It was probably the best city to be chief data officer in. Sorry.
Joy, you're with the city of San Francisco. The quote from Tim O'Reilly that I mentioned at the beginning of my little bit was actually from the launch, I believe, of SFGov a number of years ago. You're walking into a city that has a fairly long history of doing open data. Mm-hmm. What would you say the biggest challenge is coming into a place where open data has already got some roots that have taken hold?
Honestly, I mean, I think the challenge I talked about in my talk, which is trying to figure out how to motivate and sustain the change that we needed, especially once all the low-hanging fruit has dropped or been picked up or grabbed. And so I think that's our biggest challenge. And then actually cleaning up a little bit from what we've done. So having to reset, and we're embarking on what I call the great data purge of 2014. I'm really into great X of 2014. And that involves sort of cleaning up and re-looking at all our data and being like, oh, that is not being automated. We need to do that and that sort of thing.
Can you give us an example of a cleanup that was motivated by something that the public wanted changed about the data?
So crime is one where we're looking to figure out how to release a longer time on doing that. That's less of a cleanup. For us, it wasn't really necessarily motivated by external users other than hearing from our users over and over again that, wait, this isn't being updated. And so we did a mind, have gone through every data set on Data SF and tried to identify a transition strategy for it.
It sounds like when you say users, you mean both internal and external users.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Excellent. Ryan, it's the first time I heard you speak at Harvard a couple of years ago. You sort of first brought up this idea of just the presentation of open data kind of changing people's perception of government and level of trust in government. Can you talk a bit more about that research?
Absolutely. So for a number of years, I've been doing research on operational transparency. And we found, as I talked about, across a lot of domains, that there's this pattern that emerges that when people see the work that's going on behind the scenes, they perceive more effort. Mm-hmm. And when they perceive that more effort's been exerted on their behalf, they appreciate that effort and they value the service more. And so that that leads to greater satisfaction with companies, that leads to greater loyalty. And it was really gratifying for us when we started looking at it in government to see that it actually led to greater support for the government. And I think this is just the beginning. We'd love to extend this research more. We'd love to extend it to actual behaviors, show that it makes people more engaged, if that happens to be the case. So there's a lot of research left to do. So anyone out there who wants to work with me, here I am.
And if you haven't read the paper, you should.
Thanks, Joy.
Mark or Joy, since both of you have or do hold the post of CDO, I'm curious how Ryan's research sort of resonates with you in terms of how you make the argument for open data within city government.
It certainly helps. I mean, I think intuitively we believe that to be true, but it's just another tool in the toolkit to have the conversation with data owners inside government. And Joy knows this. I mean, anybody that's fought for open data inside government has heard the "why should I care about this" argument. And I think this is another brick in the structure that we can use to build open data on that really makes the case that this is the future and you need to embrace it.
Cool, thank you. Switching a little bit from the why to the how, Alan, I know from personal experience of observing this, you taught a class with a dozen different governments about how to adopt and get onto the Open Trails data standard. Can you tell us a little bit of the story of that class and things that you've learned from the experience?
Yeah, absolutely. So, we conducted a formal request for comment period in which we did a lot of outreach. We did a lot of community organizing, honestly. We worked with the folks at Esri, many of which are in the audience. We worked with folks at the National Recreation and Parks Association, which is a key source of best practices for parks, and that was really important. But road testing the specification itself outside the confines of those of us developing it and a key group of developers was really important. We wanted to see how it worked for trail agencies themselves, park agencies themselves, and so we ran a course. It was 4 weeks. We had a webinar every week, and we created a community, really, of learners. It was an educational community of people figuring out not just how to publish the open data, but how it fit into their workflows on a daily basis, and really like learning the life cycle of that particular data set. And we were really fortunate to have a clear use case for the data motivating all this.
Excellent, thank you. So still on the kind of, you know, how and the mechanics kind of angle of things, I've got a question from the audience from Carrie, who's the Chief Innovation Officer of Austin for UJoy. Carrie asks, what is your staffing model for reinvigorating San Francisco's open data plan, and how many people are on that task?
It's very creative. Staffing model, that implies a certain amount of resources that are optimistic for me. So my staffing model, or my resource strategy is how I prefer to call it, is more about, I have this image in presenting the strategic plan where there's a lot of existing amazing activity around the city, and it's sort of, it's over here and it's over here. So part of my resource strategy is sort of grabbing the strands and weaving them into something that's cohesive and helps support it. And I would say the biggest part of that is finding what I'm calling key partners and leveraging or redirecting or helping to reshape some of their activities. And then recently I had a fantastic person, Jason Lally, join the team, and he's, woo, Vina, yeah. He's awesome. I think we're also looking forward to being a little scrappy in terms of how we do things to really demonstrate additional value in terms of moving forward.
I'm curious, Mark, how you'd respond to that from the Philadelphia angle.
Similarly. when I started, I didn't have a staff, really. But the group that was charged with open data and innovation grew over time as more and more successes accrued. Trust was built, and I think people realized that we needed to invest in the group that was in charge of that. And I'm very happy to say that the person who is now Chief Data Officer in the City of Philadelphia is a terrific guy. He's bright. He's one of the all-stars. And what's even cooler is that I first met him when we were teammates at a hackathon about 5 years ago. So it's really gratifying to see him and the team that he has built, and I'm really excited to see what they're going to do.
Cool. Ryan, I'm curious what, you know, Mark just mentioned the idea of this hackathon, the kind of, you know, inclusion of the communities and the brigade structure in getting this stuff done. Has your research uncovered anything interesting about the community angle of this?
Yeah, absolutely. So in the talk, we're mostly looking at what happens with residents, what happens with citizens when government's revealed. But we've done more recent research, which actually looks at when you open up a process, it's not just the beneficiaries of that process that get value from it. It actually is also the people who are delivering that value that get value from it as well. That while for the customer, seeing the process makes them appreciate it more and value it more, if you are delivering value through a process that's open and you see your customer, you see the beneficiary of your work, you feel more appreciated and you're more satisfied with your job and you're willing to exert more effort. It's a really gratifying thought, I think, that through open data, we might actually be able to make both directions transparent and kind of a refreshingly human idea, right? Mm-hmm. That by seeing and appreciating the people who help us, there's this value that gets reciprocally created.
Mm-hmm. Alan, I'm curious what you think about that. It seems like with trail information in particular, a lot of the folks that we've seen get interested in open trails are sort of trails aficionados themselves or outdoors people themselves. I think we really saw that in the slide that you and Ryan had showing all the different supporters of the trail data standard. What is the role of the kind of community or like direct experience of trails specifically and how they might help a related data standard?
I mean, the community role is important. Parks are really special in the landscape of governments because they have these established communities of enthusiasts that really dedicate their time and energy and intellectual capacity to improving those places. And so that community has really emerged. People that love cross-country skiing, biking in particular, biking and horseback riding as well. These people that are also technologists are these natural, it's this natural constituency for the data.
Mm-hmm. It seems like in the case of trails, it's often the case that people, you know, out in the community can see a really clear kind of direct line from the data to their own enjoyment of some resource.
Absolutely.
We have a question from the audience from Molly Ruskin. Which is, I'm not really sure who to ask this of, so maybe I'm kind of curious if all of you have an opinion about this, but Molly asks, how do you make the open data case to the public? I imagine in cases where they're not already, for example, trails lovers. It often feels inaccessible. How do you make it a reality for communities facing hard issues?
I think that's a great question. I'm just going to, I think it builds off the earlier case around the transparency and that effect. And what we've actually, and we'll hopefully be releasing a little brief paper on this shortly, is we're trying to figure out how to actually evaluate the impact of open data, to measure it, to not sort of just speak or analogize or tell stories about it, but actually try and quantify it. And it's falling into four buckets for us. One is what we call economic activity. So that's both private companies using open data, but I also think it's about, you know, nonprofits being able to use that data more effectively and things like that, and in community groups. And then the government efficiency and effectiveness. And then the transparency is another piece. And then I think the resident engagement is a third or fourth. And so we're actually, we've identified metrics and we're going to start collecting data to actually measure and change impact over time.
Mark, what do you think?
Well, I think the challenge for open data advocates is to make sure that the data that we're releasing is as impactful as possible, and it will make a difference in the lives of the people that we serve. You know, the example that I just showed you with Yelp and Evanston is a good one, because I think it reaches people, and I think most people are going to consume open data through some sort of app or some visualization, mm-hmm. an infographic, a newspaper story. You know, part of the process of open data, and it is being open by default, mm-hmm. is a process, it's not an outcome. So we need to work with the consumers of our data and the communities around it mm-hmm. to help them use it in ways that that further the goals of government.
Mm-hmm. Jake Solomon on Twitter also asks a kind of related question. I think, Ryan, I'm curious what you think about this. Jake wonders, can you open data without identifying specific or compelling use cases first? And is this worth the effort? And I ask you because it seems like you've really identified something that's almost independent of the content of the data itself, but is just purely about the transparency effort.
Yeah, and I think this links to something that Mark just said, right? That we don't really know all of the use cases. We know that there are unmet needs out there, and we know that there is a brilliant public and a brilliant community that can help take that data and do important and meaningful things with it. So I think that there certainly is a faith case that if the information gets out there, that great things can happen. But I think there's just a more fundamental point, which is that that by revealing what's going on with the government, mm-hmm. what's revealing the actual work that's going on inside the government, we can appreciate it and engage with it in new and different ways than we ever could have thought to before. Mm-hmm. Some of these unmet latent needs won't express themselves until people understand, wow, I can actually solve that problem mm-hmm. through this department or through the parks or through other facets of government.
Transit Mix is a great example of that, mm-hmm. Right? So GTFS, transit data, it's used to help people actually use the transit system on a daily basis. It's changed the lives of millions of people who went from waiting 15 minutes in the hot Louisiana sun on a July afternoon to like staying inside in the air conditioning with their children. But Transit Mix takes this data, reinterprets it, and turns it into a tool for transit planners to actually reimagine the service level they're able to provide. So I think that's a great example.
But I think the reality is we need a mix of strategies, right? We will continue to do what I call the drip strategy, which is like drip, 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 and hope someone takes our drips and does something magical with them, and that's great. But we also need more deliberate strategies where we're not simply just releasing the data out there and hoping someone adds value. And that's why we're migrating to one of our additional publishing strategies being about what we're calling strategic releases, where we're going to take a cluster of data sets, we're going to package them, and we're going to release them around some theme, whether it's a pressing information challenge or need. So I think you have to have a mix of strategies.
Yeah, I'd add to that and say that, you know, anybody that's been inside government working to release data knows that it's work. And you know, there's been some great talk this week about ETL tools and that the whole process of getting data out. And we don't have limitless resources, so yeah. We have to be strategic and judicious in picking what we apply those resources to. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely something that we need to think about.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Mark, Ryan, Joy, Alan, and Ryan backstage. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.